It's great to be back here after 2 weeks away, and then I'm going to be away for another 2 weeks, but there you go. It's great to see you. Somebody asked me what I've been doing. I did a lot of reading. I went to Regina for a few days to watch the Canadian Little League Championships. It was very fun. And then just some quiet time. Please turn, for those who are not usually here or have forgotten, on the inside, second page of your bulletin are the prayer over the gifts, the breaking of the bread, and those kinds of things, and then everything else, either I'll tell you about it or it will be in your bulletin. We begin on page 185 of the Book of Common Prayer, the Green Prayer Book, page 185. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. And together we say the glory to God on page 186. Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
And the collect for today. Through the storms of life, O God, you walk with your people in the person of Jesus, your Son. Calm our fears and strengthen our faith, so that we may never doubt his presence among us, but proclaim that he is your Son, risen from the dead, living forever. Amen. Please be seated to listen to the readings.
A reading from Genesis. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem, and Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." He answered, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. The man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where they are pasturing the flock." The man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, Let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of their hands, saying, let us not take his life. Reuben said to them, shed no blood. Throw him into this pit there in the wilderness, but lay no hands on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into a pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels carrying gum, balm, and resin, on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, what profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh. And his brothers agreed. When some Midianite traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is Psalm 105, verses 1 to 6, and then 16 to 22, and then 45. We begin on page 845, verses 1 to 6, and we will read it responsively by the half verse. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name.
Make known his deeds among the peoples.
Sing to him, sing praises to him.
And speak of all his marvelous works.
Glory in his holy name.
Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Search for the Lord and his strength.
Continually seek his faces.
Remember the marvels he has done.
His wonders and judgments of his mouth.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant.
O children of David, his chosen.
And now we go down to verse 16. Then he called for a famine in the land.
And destroyed the supply of bread.
He sent a man before them.
Joseph, who was sold as a slave.
They bruised his feet in fetters.
His neck whipped in an iron collar.
Until his prediction came to pass.
The word of the Lord attested him.
The king sent and released him.
The rulers of the people set him free.
He set him as master over his household.
As a ruler over all his possessions.
To instruct his princes according to his will.
And to teach his elders wisdom.
And verse 45. Together we just say the word hallelujah. Hallelujah. And together we pray.
God, our salvation, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have fulfilled your promise to our ancestors in the faith to redeem the world from slavery and to lead us into the promised land. Grant us living water from the rock and bread from heaven, that we may survive our desert pilgrimage and praise you forever, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one who confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in turn will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel.
Gloria, Gloria.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." "Lord, since it is you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," Jesus said. Then Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiping him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise Gloria, 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 Alleluia, Alleluia.
May the Spirit of God be at work. Amen. Please be seated. As you can see, Deacon Larry is not here today. He's somewhere on the way to Alaska, where hopefully it's a bit cooler. This morning's gospel reading from Matthew takes us right into a storm. A storm on the Sea of Galilee. The waves battered the boat, and the wind was against the 12 disciples who were in the boat. Jesus was not with them. He had stayed behind to be alone and to pray. The disciples don't seem to be afraid. After all, they are fishermen. They're used to storms. They feel safe in the boat. And it's almost morning when they look and they think they see something. And they are afraid, not of the wind, but of what they think is a ghost. The word, the Greek word, is a phantasma, phantasma. They scream in fear, but Jesus says to them, "Take heart, it's me. Do not be afraid." We hear those "do not be afraid" words all the time, don't we? Well, Peter seems to hear Jesus' words about being courageous and not being afraid as an invitation to do something. Seems a bit crazy. He decides to jump out of the boat. He says, "Okay, it's you, Jesus, so invite me to come out of the boat and to walk on the water with you." Peter is the disciple who often speaks before he thinks things through and acts without a good plan. He's impulsive. Jesus calls Peter to join him and he says, "Okay, Peter, jump out of the boat into the waves with me." Into the waves with Jesus. And lo and behold, Peter walks on the water towards Jesus. Until he realizes that he's walking on the water and he starts to sink. Does anybody remember those Roadrunner cartoons? You know, when the Roadrunner and the coyote follows him and off the cliff and he's in the air until he looks down and then he starts to sink. This is like Peter. He realized what he was doing and he started to sink. And he cries out, "Lord, save me," and Jesus is right there. Right there, reaching out his hand to catch Peter. And Jesus says to him, Why did you doubt you could do it? Oh, you of little faith." The other disciples witness this and realize that Jesus truly is the Son of God. In the storm, they know him to be the Son of God. But what about that phrase, "O you of little faith"? Is Jesus really chastising Peter, scolding Peter for not being able to walk on water? In my study Bible, it says that "O you of little faith" is a frequent rebuke of the disciples. And, you know, that just doesn't make sense to me. Why would those disciples stick with Jesus if he kept on chastising them for having little faith, like a bad school teacher, seeming like he's fed up with them all the time? I just don't see that. I think we should hear those words differently. And it's a real temptation when we're reading the Bible or we're hearing it out loud to have the voice of Jesus to be like an old wise man who sees everything that's wrong. And what I try to remember is that the Son of God was fully human, fully. And that must mean that he had a sense of humor, that he felt not only compassion for people, but tenderness to his friends. That, I mean, he chose them. He chose them. And often I think instead of hearing the word of Jesus as stern and humorless, with a finger wagging, "You of little faith, you." It should sound like, "Oh, you of little faith. Oh, you of little faith." I think maybe Jesus was responding to his friends saying, "Didn't you know I would be here for you? Don't doubt that." And only as friends can say to each other, meaning, "Of course I'm here with you. You don't need to sink to the bottom, okay? So you got a little wet, now we'll get through this together." This is the more loving and compassionate and response. And God is a love, a God of love and compassion. Some theologians think that the phrase, "you of little faith," is a term of affection for his 12 disciples. He only uses this phrase with his 12 disciples, and it's a teasing and a bantering that he saves for his closest friends. So as Peter is about to sink, Jesus offers him a hand and addresses him by what we have now seen, or what we could see if we want to, a term of real affection. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" I don't know if any of you know Father James Martin. He's a Jesuit priest. He's written a bunch of books on everything, and he has a Friday Bible study that started during COVID. And he wrote, one of his books is Between Heaven and Mirth, and he has written all about the humorous things that we can find. And a couple of things that he says is that, you know, Peter's name isn't really Peter, it's Simon, right? Son of Jonah. But he calls him Peter, which is a Greek word for Rocky. So he's got his friend Rocky there. And someone that I was reading this week suggested that maybe he gave him that name because he sunk like a stone. He went down in the water like a stone. So this is his friend Rocky he's talking to. And we all know the story of the mustard seed. We were talking about mustard seeds for a while there back. And Jesus tells that story when the disciples say, "Give us more faith." And he says to them, "That faith as small as a mustard seed can do wonders. Little faith is all that God needs to work with." God can work wonders with us and our little faith. I don't know about you. I think maybe you don't have these, but I sometimes feel like I don't have any more than a little faith. When I worry if I am good enough or if I pray enough. I wonder about little faith when I realize I've been unkind or impatient to someone or not as generous as I ought to be. And then I realize that God loves me no matter what, you know, this constant cycle, and that God loves all of us no matter what or what the circumstances are. Jesus loves us as friends with tender, compassionate, honest, and strong love when the sea is calm and when there is a raging storm out there. And there is a raging storm out there, isn't there? We're still recovering from the worst of COVID, which kept us from gathering for so very long. And the storm of larger systemic injustices, racial injustice, violence, poverty, climate crisis, homelessness, addiction, loneliness. We could make a very long list. This is our storm. Right now at St. John the Baptist, we are safely in our own boat. You may know that one of the ancient symbols of a church is a boat. And if you look up at the architecture of this place and in your mind, turn it around, you will see the hull of a boat. That the architecture of a church often mimics the architecture, the mirror architecture of the hull of a boat. And it meant a vessel of salvation, which means healing and fullness. And it was often used to portray the church, which I find very cool. So we are in a boat together in the church. Not only the physical church, but the people of the church. And we are crew members, all of us. Every single person that's here today is a crew member of this, the good ship St. John the Baptist Church with Anglican roots in the Universal Church. And we learn and are nurtured in this safe vessel of salvation, of healing and prayer and friendship. And I think that God calls us, if we want to read this story this way, out of the safety of our familiar ways, our familiar safety and comfort. And I think Peter had the right idea. I don't think he was crazy at all. He jumped out of the boat to where Jesus was in the midst of the storm. And sometimes our impulses or intuition or instincts are the voice of God. Sometimes God just says, jump out of that boat. I mean, if you saw somebody hurt on the road, hit by a car, or suddenly fell down, you wouldn't sit there and sort of go through the doctrine of your faith and wonder, what should I do? You'd probably just go out there and help them into that storm. And Jesus is saying, yeah, come with me into this storm. That's why he's here. Look around your neighborhood and your city. Who needs help? Who is out in that storm? Are people well fed? Do they have shelter? Well, we know the answer to those questions. Appallingly, the answer is no. If we do jump out of the boat into the storm, we will find Christ there. The hand of Christ is always there, ready to keep us from sinking, telling us not to be afraid and to write that letter of government, that letter to the government about affordable housing, about our burning and drowning planet, telling us to wear a mask to protect our friends and strangers. We still sometimes are in the position of having to wear a mask, not to be afraid to say hello to someone who's not like you. Perhaps this is a homeless person on the street asking for money, and they're someone's child of God. We are called to be the hand of God to others in the storm. Always connection, holding your hands together with the hands of God and the hands of someone else. There is always a storm somewhere. Always the support and loving tenderness and strength of God to guide us where we need to be. We need to follow with faith, no matter how great or how little that faith is. The hand of God guides us, leads us, and saves us. Amen. Please rise for the Creed. This morning, let's read the Nicene Creed. On page 188, with Christians around the world and across time, let us confess our faith as we say,
we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen,
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, she is worshipped and glorified. She has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated for the prayers of the people.
Today's lessons we heard through the storms of life, our faith is tested, our hope is tested, and our belief is tested. With that in mind, think of Psalm 46, verse 10. It says, "Be still and know that I am God." That will be our refrain after each intercession. Help us to get rid of the clutter that holds us back from knowing you, Lord. So let us pray. Merciful God, we bring to you the prayers of the world and its people. Victims of war, victims of national disasters. We think of the people of the Ukraine, the people who have been affected by forest fires in BC and Alberta and lately Maui. They feel that they have no hope. They are tested by this. Please join me. Be still and know I am God. We bring to you the prayers for the people of your church, the leaders and executives of the Anglican Church of Canada, our Bishop John, our priest in charge Liz, our deacon Larry. We pray for our organists and choir, our altar guild, and our Thursday work guys. We pray for Stephen, our parish administrator. Lord, we especially pray for our parish council and canonical committee. They face the task of wading through the minefield of procedures and interview for our new priest. They are tested by this. Be still and know that I am God. We bring to you the prayers for all in need, for those who suffer physically, those who find themselves in emotional upheaval, those who are alone, those who do not know where their next meal is coming from, those who have no permanent shelter. Lord, watch over those who travel and bring them to the safe end of their journey. And we especially pray for Dave and Linda. Be still and know that I am God. We bring to you the prayers for all who have died in faith. Reverend Paul McMullen and Nevia. We who are left are tested. Help us to know that through the rough seas of life, you will provide us with a safe harbor. Be still and know that I am God. And all the people who are keeping faith, keeping hope, holding strong to our beliefs, we all said together, Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. God welcomes sinners and invites us to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Page 191. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you, our Father, and great deed, by what we have done, and by what you have left not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand for the peace. May the peace of God be always with you.
And also with you.
We share an exalt symbol of peace. I like that. Peace. Okay. And we sing our hymn, number 509. Precious Lord, take my hand. Together we pray the prayer over the gifts. Compassionate One, receive all we offer you this day, and grant that in this Eucharist
we may be enriched by the gifts of the Spirit. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise. Human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He healed the sick and ate and drank with outcasts and sinners. He opened the eyes of the blind and proclaimed the good news of your kingdom to the poor and to those in need. In all things, he fulfilled your gracious will. On the night he freely gave himself to death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Gracious God, in his perfect sacrifice, he destroys the power of sin and death. By raising him to life, you give us life forevermore. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Recalling his death, proclaiming his resurrection, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you, Father, this bread and this cup. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that all who eat and drink at this table may be one body and one holy people, a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
turn to page 211. And together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us as it is written at the top of the page. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I am the bread of life, says the Lord. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him. If you know the brokenness of life, its fractures within and its division without, then you have participated in the broken body of Christ, and you are invited to share in the breaking of the bread. If you desire to know the love of God that overcomes indifference and despair, if you desire the reconciliation that overcomes estrangement and alienation, then you are invited to share in the wine, the cup of healing. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Everyone is welcome at this table. Want to receive from the cup, come this way. And if you would like a tincted host, come this way. Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal God, grant to your church the unity and peace that we have tasted in this Eucharist, the fruit of your life-giving Spirit. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Please rise. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we could ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Announcements. It's hot. It's really hot. I mean, that's not the announcement, but because it's hot, we really have to take care of ourselves. Often we don't realize how hot we are until we're too hot. So please, you know, don't go running outside and stay as cool as possible. If that means going to the mall, you know, you might have to go to the mall. Drink lots of water. We're all susceptible to this strange weather, and the next time I'm here, I don't want to see anybody missing. Any other announcements that anybody would like to make? Does anybody have any birthdays or anniversaries this week? Oh, somebody's prodding somebody over there. So you can stay anonymous if you want to, those of you who are going to be experiencing another trip around the sun, and we will pray for you. God knows who you are. Oh, merciful Savior, as we are brought to this new day, refreshed and encouraged, we are thankful for the opportunity to celebrate this special day in the lives of our anonymous friends. May their lives be consecrated to your service. May they be granted long life, health, and happiness. And may we, their friends, continue to enjoy their fellowship in this community. Amen. Amen. Please rise. Life is short. We do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So make haste to love and be swift to be kind. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you today and be with you and those you love forever. Amen. Now we sing our final hymn, which is Come and Journey with a Savior, hymn number 482.
Come and journey
before you are dismissed, one last thank you to Garrett for supporting us with music this morning. Thank you, Garrett. Let us all go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.